Hello, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Exotic Astrology. And after a long time, we are starting with the Srimad Bhagavatam playlist again. And hopefully, I will do it regularly from now on. And today, we will address a very important question: how to satisfy others, or maybe yourself also. Because many times this question is asked that I try to satisfy this person is not satisfied. I try to satisfy him, her, or they, or anybody. Or sometimes we can't even satisfy ourselves, our own mind and senses. All right, so how to satisfy ourselves and everybody else and the universe? So today the secret is there in this verse. And if we just do what is mentioned in this verse, then we do not need to satisfy anybody, not including ourselves. We don't even have to satisfy ourselves. Okay. Now, when I say we don't have to satisfy ourselves or we don't have to satisfy anybody, if you do this, it does not mean that you cut your relations with everybody or you stop eating or you stop earning money. I'm not saying that. But whatever you do, whoever you try to satisfy, yourself, others, or everybody, but there is one thing which you must do. Only when you do that, then only the satisfaction is complete. Otherwise, no completion. Always you will feel that something is lacking. When you try to satisfy yourself, you will feel something is lacking. And when you try to satisfy somebody else, that person will feel, no, there's something lacking. You know, I need more. It's like an unlimited quench of thirst, which never gets quenched actually. All right, so today we shall start with the next verse of the Srimad Bhagavatam, the first canto, first chapter, fourth verse. All right, so we did the third verse in quite a bit of parts, and now finally, by the grace of Vyasdev, we have reached the fourth verse. So let us start. And here it is. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. This is generally said before we recite the prayers of Srimad Bhagavatam. Okay. And we'll also offer our prayers to our preceptors and our gurus and our guides who have blessed us profusely, without whose blessings we would have not reached here. Om Agyan Timirandhasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namah. Okay, so let us start now. So I will read the shloka first. So whenever we read any scriptural verse, we must read the shloka, the Sanskrit first. Okay, we should not just jump and keep skimming through the translation or the purport. We must read the shloka once, okay, in Sanskrit at least. All right, so the background, as you know, is that Srimad Bhagavatam is spoken by Sukhdev Goswami, and this is mentioned in the third verse. Okay, Sukha Mukhad Amrita Davya Samyutam, which means when Sukhdev Goswami spoke the Srimad Bhagavatam, it became more beautiful, it became more sweet, it became more enlightening, it became more enlivening. All right, and then now here we will see something which is mentioned about the sages of Naimisharanya. Naimisharanya is a forest in India, and there was a person called Sut Goswami. Sut Goswami had gone and spoken what he heard from Sukhdev Goswami to the sages of Naimisharanya. Okay. So I'll recap this again, because this is a bit confusing sometimes. So what happened was, Parikshit Maharaj got a curse that he will die in 7 days. And when he assembled, then all the great sages of the entire universe came, and then they unanimously selected Sukhdev Goswami. Okay, and then Sukhdev Goswami, he's son of Vyasdev. Vyasdev is the compiler of all the scriptures. And then he spoke the Srimad Bhagavatam. Okay. And who did he hear this from? He heard this from his father Vyas. All right. Vyasdev only. And then in that assembly, there is another Rishi. His name is Sut Goswami. Don't confuse. The one who is speaking is Sukhdev Goswami. S-U-K. All right. So Sukha means parrot. And the one who is listening, he's one of the sages in the among the many sitting there. His name is Sut Goswami, S-U-T-A. So Sut Goswami later on goes to a forest called Naimisharanya. And then there's another big gathering of sages. And he speaks what he heard from Sukhdev Goswami to these group of sages. Okay. And who is the leader of these sages in Naimisharanya? The leader is Shaunak Rishi. So Shaunak Rishi is asking questions to Sut Goswami on behalf of all the sages. Okay. All right. So now let us start. First canto, first chapter, fourth verse. Okay. Fourth verse. Naimishe Nimisha Chetre Rasaya Shaunakadaya Satram Swargaya Lokaya Sahasra Samam Asata. So the translation is, once in a holy place in the forest of Naimisharanya, great sages headed by the sage Shaunak assembled to perform a 1,000-year sacrifice for the satisfaction of the Lord and his devotees. 1,000-year sacrifice, my God. So let's jump to the purport. The prelude of the Srimad Bhagavatam was spoken in the previous three shlokas. Now the main topic of this great literature is being presented. Srimad Bhagavatam, after its recitation by Srila Sukhdev Goswami, was repeated for the second time at Naimisharanya. Okay, Sut Goswami repeated this. Now, in the Vayavaya Tantra, it is said that Brahma, the engineer of this particular universe, contemplated a great wheel which could enclose the universe. The hub of this great circle was fixed at a particular place known as Naimisharanya. Wow. So whenever you go to India, please visit Naimisharanya. Okay, you can Google it where Naimisharanya is. That is your homework. So the wheel which could enclose the entire universe, which Lord Brahma had contemplated, that the center of that wheel passes through Naimisharanya. So it's a very important place, very powerful and very spiritually potent place. Similarly, there is another reference to the forest of Naimisharanya in the Varaha Purana, where it is stated that by the performance of sacrifice at this place, the strength of the demoniac people is curtailed. Thus, Brahmanas prefer Naimisharanya for such sacrificial performances. All right. So, demoniac people means the people who are doing wrong activities in this world, who are hurting others, who are killing others, who are terrorizing others, who are cheating others. That's the meaning of the word demoniac. So that means if you want to do special tapasya, places like Naimisharanya, Kurukshetra, Kanchipuram, these are very important places, okay? And this is mentioned where? This is mentioned in the Varaha Purana. The devotees of Lord Vishnu offer all kinds of sacrifices for his pleasure. The devotees are always attached to the service of the Lord. Whereas fallen souls are attached to the pleasures of material existence. Wow. In Bhagavad Gita, it is said that anything performed in the material world for any reason other than the pleasure of Lord Vishnu causes further bondage for the performer. Well, which shloka is indicating this? Okay, so that's your homework. So open the Gita and find and write it down in the comments. Which shloka says that any work that is not performed for the pleasure of Lord Vishnu causes further bondage? Which shloka says this? Okay, it is enjoined, therefore, that all acts must be performed sacrificially for the satisfaction of Lord Vishnu and his devotees. This will bring everyone peace and prosperity. The great sages are always anxious to do good to the people in general. And as such, the sages headed by Shaunaka and others assembled at this holy place of Naimisharanya with a program of performing a great and continuous chain of sacrificial ceremonies. All right. Forgetful men do not know that the right path for peace. Forgetful men do not know the right path for peace and prosperity. However, the sages know it well, and therefore, for the good of all men, they are always anxious to perform acts which may bring them about peace in the world. So basically, this is indicating towards the fact that when we perform spiritual activities in this life, then we become more happier from inside as a person, and then our necessities will reduce automatically. External necessities of the body will reduce artificially. Okay, I mean, the artificial necessities will reduce drastically. So by that, as the famous saying goes, no, that the earth can produce for everyone, but not for one person's greed. No, one famous person had said this. So this means, though, if you see any problem in this world, why is there a problem? Because there's selfishness. That's only the reason because of which there is a problem in this world. Okay, like hunger problem. Why is it? Because so many people are, you know, destroying food. So many countries, so many governments. There's poverty. Why? Because people are not able to handle the money properly. There's mismanagement of money. And that's where spirituality comes, that when we become more elevated, then we do not feel the need for money. Not that we do not earn money. Earning money is not wrong. But the point is, where are you spending your money? Okay, that is important. However, the sages know it well, and therefore, for the good of all men, they are always anxious to perform acts which may bring about peace in the world. They are sincere friends to all living entities, and at the risk of great personal inconvenience, they are always engaged in the service of the Lord for good of all people. Lord Vishnu is just like a great tree, and all others, including the demigods, men, siddhas, charanas, vidyadharas, and other living entities are like the branches, twigs, and the leaves of that tree. Very interesting analogy. By pouring water, there is the secret, you see. By pouring water on the root of the tree, all the parts of the tree are automatically nourished. Only those branches and leaves which are detached cannot be so satisfied. Detached branches and leaves dry out gradually despite all watering attempts. Similarly, human society, when it is detached from the personality of Godhead like detached branches and leaves, is not capable of being watered. And one attempting to do so is simply wasting his energy and resources. All right, so basically this means that if somebody is not connected to God, then whatever he or she may do in this world will ultimately land him in frustration. Okay, whatever the person does, that is the meaning. Now, this does not mean that the material things cannot satisfy us. It can satisfy us, definitely, to some extent. But the problem is, we are not this body. We are spirit soul. So, spirit soul means anandamayo bhyasa, which means the Vedanta Sutra says that anandamayo bhyasat. Ananda means bliss, eternal bliss. Anandamaya means bhyasat, which means we are made for eternal bliss. All right, sat chit ananda, full of eternity, full of knowledge, full of bliss. Sat chit ananda, all the three. So material things can definitely satisfy us to a certain extent, because currently our consciousness is radiating through matter, which means we feel consciousness through matter, which means that if somebody touches my hand and pricks with hits with a stone, then I will feel pain. So this gives me a feeling that I exist in this world. I am living, I am not dead. Right? But the problem is, this body is not me. I am separate from this body. Okay? But because our consciousness is so gross at this stage of our spiritual journey, therefore anything and everything that happens to the body, we feel affected very much. Okay, so many times people tell me that when somebody comments on their looks, you know, they feel very bad. So suppose a person is going and you tell that person, no? Maybe you have gained weight, or you have lost weight, or what happened? You are not looking the way you used to look once upon a time. So then people really feel bad, and they really feel that they have been dejected, or they have been downplayed. These kind of things they feel. Everybody feels, right? Nobody is an exception. Why is it? Because we think that we are this body. So it's like saying, suppose somebody tells a person that, you are not looking good. Then we hear it as if the person is telling you are not good. The person told you are not looking good, which means the body is not looking good. But we will hear it as if I am only bad, I am only not good. Okay. So imagine I have this, I have this cup here. I don't know if you can see, it's written, never stop dreaming. That's what is written here. Yes, now you can see. So now suppose somebody comes and says, this cup doesn't look good. Okay. Now, of course, it looks beautiful, no doubt. But suppose somebody comes and tells, this cup doesn't look good. So how much bad will I feel? Well, I'll feel bad. But I will not start crying, or I will not start arguing with the person. I will be like, okay, if you don't like, then don't see it. But the question is, why will I feel bad if somebody insults this cup? Because I have an identification. Okay, this is my cup, you see. So anybody insulting this cup is like insulting me. Okay, so similarly, the highest amount of identification that we have with anything of this material world is with our own body. And therefore, anybody says anything against the body, we become very cautious, we become alert. Anybody saying good things about our body, so suppose somebody says, you are looking great, then we feel very good. This person, So we hear as if the person is saying, you are great. Not you are looking great, but you yourself are so great. We hear as if the person has said like that. We because the consciousness is so much into the body, anything that happens with the body, we identify with it. All right. So the material things, all the material things, whatever is there in this world, from food, any materialistic pleasure, the pleasure of the opposite sex, sexuality, or anything, it can be luxury, vehicles, anything of this world. Their domain is only till the body. No materialistic pleasure can touch the soul. So when we are identifying with the body, to some extent, they can give us some temporary tinge of pleasure. Okay, but they cannot satisfy us internally, because internally, the soul is looking for spiritual happiness, which is beyond matter, which cannot be obtained from these things. Okay, and that happens when we are practicing spirituality going towards Lord Vishnu. Otherwise, what happens is our consciousness is directed towards the mundane things of this world. Okay, and then there's no satisfaction. That is why you see in this world these days, divorces are increasing, fights are increasing, quarrels are increasing, wars are increasing. Literally every country, there is problem of insurgency, there is war, there is governments are fighting with each other. So many problems. Why? Because everybody is selfish. Everybody is just seeing their own agenda. I, me and mine. All right. Nobody is thinking of God. If anybody were to think, then they would realize that I have my karma and that person has his or her karma. Let me try my best to help that person. But that consciousness is not there now. And that's why so much disharmony in this world. All right. So the answer is, we have to harmonize ourselves, and we have to realize that unless we get spiritual happiness, then all the things are of not much use. So the example is given of a branch which is not linked with the tree anymore. Okay. So suppose there is a tree and there is a leaf. So I pluck the leaf and I throw it. So then what happens? Initially, the leaf looks to be green. It looks to be just like any other leaf of the tree, right? Initially, some few minutes, or maybe for 1 or 2 hours. But then after a few hours, what happens? The leaf doesn't stay green anymore. It becomes pale. And after some time or after some days, the leaf disappears. All right. So that's the analogy, that whatever we are doing, if we are not having a spiritual consciousness, then it's like that leaf which will eventually fade. All right. And that's what happens. People have so much these days, but there's no happiness. Hardly people are happy, you see. All right. So the last two parts. The modern materialistic society is detached from its relation to the Supreme Lord, which means the modern people are not following any spiritual processes. And all its plans, which are being made by atheistic leaders, are sure to be baffled at every step. Yet they do not wake up to this. Atheistic leaders, you see. In this age, the congregational chanting of the holy names of the Lord is the prescribed method for waking up. Now, this Lord Krishna also says in the Gita, na? Krishna says, among sacrifices, I am the chanting of the holy name. The ways and means are most scientifically presented by Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and intelligent persons may take advantage of his teachings in order to bring about real peace and prosperity. Srimad Bhagavatam is also presented for the same purpose, and this will be explained more specifically later in the text. All right, so we will discuss more about the chanting of the holy name in the later verses. And the point is, whoever we try to satisfy, either it is ourselves or anybody else, if we are not doing spiritual practices ourselves, then we what to speak of satisfying others? We cannot even satisfy ourselves. Okay, so how if we are only not satisfied, then how can we go and satisfy somebody else? Okay, so this does not mean that you have to go to the forest, you have to resign from your job, you have to take sannyas, and you have to just disappear. It does not mean that. It means whatever you are doing, either you are single, you are married, you have your job, your business, you have children, or you don't, whatever is your situation external, irrespective of your externals, you just have to include spiritual practices in your life daily. Only then you will realize that there is much more to life than just mundane materialistic things. Okay, so whatever is coming of its own accord, accept it. There's no problem in that. But try to do spiritual practices like chanting mantras in the morning, then listening to lectures of spiritual gurus, that you can do in the day. And then reading scriptures like the Bhagavad Gita or the Srimad Bhagavatam. All right, that's very important. And when you come home in the evening, instead of just wasting time watching the TV and the news, you can talk about spirituality with your husband, with your wife, with your mother, with your father, with your son, with your daughter, with your sister, with your cousin, with your neighbors, whoever is there. All right. Instead of discussing about the useless rubbish, garbage of this world, like, you know, movies, politics, or what happened in your office. Well, nobody is interested to know what's going on, because everybody knows there's politics all around the place. Okay. So let us use our time and make it beneficial for us. Okay. And not just waste it just by watching TV or by watching cricket or doing all this stuff, because then we will be bereft of the human body's capabilities and our possibilities to open doors to liberation. Okay, liberation from suffering, basically. Okay, and at the end, that's what is the conclusion, that try to satisfy yourself first and then help others. Okay, and how do you satisfy yourself? Take care of your material needs and do spiritual activities. That is like watering the root of the tree. So when Lord Vishnu is satisfied, then you will be satisfied. And when you are satisfied, only then you can satisfy others. All right. Thank you very much for your patient hearing. And as usual, if you are new to the channel, then please subscribe to it. And if you like this video, click the thumbs up and share it with somebody who wants to know how to satisfy ourselves and the universe and others, of course. Okay. And yes, God is there with you all the time. Just look to him and you will find him. And yes, if you want a consultation from me regarding any area of your life, then you can go down to the description section where you will find the link to my website. Okay, thank you very much.